Present the initial project to you, get your guys' feedback, and show you how we're trying to make this corridor a better place. So, go to the next slide, Jerry. So first, I want to just introduce the team, starting with you, Jerry. If you guys can, team can go around, just say what you are, what you do.
Thank you, Nate. My name is Jerry Hernandez. I work with the City of LA Bureau of Engineering, and I am the project manager on this project. Behind here, I have our team.
My name is Rob Bathke with David Evans Associates, and we're the prime consultant doing the design work for the project on behalf of the city, and we have Rich with GBA here.
And we're doing the environmental.
David Lewis, I'm the project manager, helping Rob out, working with the city to get the CEQA clearance done.
Anybody else?
Billy? Hi everyone, my name is Billy Hill. I'm with the City of LA. I work for the Bureau of Engineering. With the environmental management group.
Yes. All right. So before we go into the team resources a little bit, I want to explain just sort of a little background on what this is. So, and it'll be discussed more later, but this is an opportunity to make a transformative improvement to the Soto corridor. How many people have driven down here and seeing like mudslides totally taking over one of the travel lanes? Yeah. Or you see like a kid walking on that really jacked up sidewalk alongside Forever 21. You're just like, why? That's crazy. Why are they doing it? So this is an opportunity to really help connect this corridor. As you all know, there's the current project that's almost complete. Right. A few more trees to plant, put a plaque in, a piece of the old bridge. That should be done probably the end of this month or something.
That's right.
That, as well as the widening of the Soto Valley Bridge to make that more accessible, is going to create this corridor through the neighborhood to really help make it a more welcoming environment so people can walk around, they can get places, and really sort of add value to the community. So between the three of them, we're talking about $50 million worth of projects. So it's pretty exciting, all this stuff going on. I'm going to go over the team resources.
So Jerry. Yeah, I just wanted to show this slide here to kind of show who's going to be involved with the project and what's it going to take to get this project complete. And we're going to have DOT involved to review the traffic plans, signal improvements, rear street lighting to bring in new lights along the whole corridor, street services, environmental management division, and Department of Cultural Affairs to bring in art concepts into the project. We'll be thinking about maybe doing an improvement on the Hillside Village sign here that's on the corner right here in front of the store there. That might be a possibility. And of course, LADWP, we're looking at possibly removing the overhead poles here and bringing it underground. That's going to be a lot of work and effort that's going to have to be done with them as well. So a lot of players involved within the city, and you know, we have a great team, which I think, you know, are going to be helping us out to make it happen. So that's where we're at.
So first step, we'll do the video in a second, but as you guys can see what's going on out there right now, they're almost done with the Soto Mission Bridge removal. It's been about a $20 million project.
Wow, yeah.
So this is the northernmost portion of this vision for an improved corridor. And as you can see, they've got the beautiful butterflies. Has anyone seen them? I'm flying around, which are lit up at night. They're gonna be planting another 20 trees or so
in the
next week or two to ensure that the area is well planted. Bureau of Street Services will be having their landscape contractor maintain it. It's being put into the citywide contract, so it's not gonna be a maintenance hazard. So that's the northernmost portion of the area. And I know it's sort of, we're being circuitous into what we're getting to, but I wanna paint the full picture so you guys can understand why the project's going on. So, do you have the video ready?
Yeah, we wanted to share a video we compiled together since.
There, sorry guys. Get this sound. It's actually worth it. It's pretty cool.
I'll get this.
That's a new city hall.
Okay.
Well, this right here is almost what you call the finished product of the project here, the landscape portion being in there.
The red curve?
The
red curve?
Yeah. And we parked it, well, that's what I think they came in, right?
You have to have it for fire department, so they can turn around.
This goes back to December 2014, when we started doing demolition, maintaining one lane on the bridge open still. Those are the folks there, and the aerial drone that we use for the construction process. One of the major challenges is, as you know, is demolishing the bridge while maintaining traffic open at all times. That was like, you know, one of the main challenges we encountered throughout the whole project. You know, maintaining that, you know, keep the dust control, the noise level, vibration level, and all that within, you know, the city standards.
I feel like the movies, this dramatic music. So, completed project is going to have a piece of one of those iron or steel put on a plaque in the new project area to give a little history on the old bridge.
Here we start working on the street improvement areas now around the bridge area.
Back a few slides. Okay, so yeah, go to the next one. So Soto Valley Bridge widening is the southernmost portion of this. What they're going to be doing is widening Soto Valley and get rid of that awful speed hump that launches everybody in the air when you're driving northbound. You just feel everything just go boom. This was a project that actually the state was going to delay for 5 to 6 years, But fortunately, we have great people in the Bureau of Engineering. Jerry, his boss, his team was able to ensure that the project wasn't delayed. So that project is also going to fix some of the sidewalks north of the bridge as well. I think it goes up to the alley just where it starts to widen going northbound. Yeah, exactly. So between the three of these projects, we expect to be completed all by the end of 2020. We're going to have this nice area from Soto Mission the whole way down. So this is the middle component of all those projects. So I want you guys just to see that sort of huge context before we go into the project, which is our next step. So I'm going to turn it over to Jerry.
Okay, so this is an aerial 3D view of the project limits that we're all pretty much familiar with. And so up here is the Soto Bridge Removal Project. This is the Soto Roadway Project right here. And so as you can see, there's a lot of earthwork that's going to have to be involved as far as that hillside in there. And looking, the city has a 70-foot right-of-way along the whole corridor. Actually, there's a 90-foot right-of-way between, like, halfway between the corridor, which the city owns. The other half is owned by this private owner on this side over there, which the city's going to have to acquire. Robbie Watkin will step in here and provide any information. But yeah, this is just an aerial view of what we're looking at.
When you say 70 foot, from where 70 foot?
I'll show you a cross-section right now. You can get a better understanding of it. So what are the main project goals? The main project goals, we think, is to improve transportation by adding additional lanes, providing bicycle improvements, as well as for pedestrians. So we're really looking at those three things as we're improving this whole corridor here. These are just some of the photos of the existing conditions of Soto Roadway widening here. You can see the sidewalk here is really bad condition. It's actually toppling over onto the Forever 21 facilities here. As Nate was mentioning, I drove this area for about 3 years going back and forth for the other project. And I recall a few times too where the soil just kept down after a long rain, hard storm rain. It was always that lane you had to be careful with it, it's going down and moving over. So, you know, it's definitely a big improvement, I think, once we get the project going. Improving the runoff with the storm is going to be another one that we're going to be looking at. So this is the Hillside Village monument that's there right now. So that's something we're looking at maybe improving as well. So the, Rob, I'll let you.
Sure. Yeah, like Jerry's been talking about, the project has many components. And Nate hit on this earlier. There's been a lot of times you've been walking, you know, driving down there, and you see people walking on the sidewalk or something on the one side of the street. That's not a very good scenario. There's no real facilities for bicycle use. So the project has several components. One of them is to get another vehicular lane in there, but at least as importantly is to get bicycle use, safe bicycle use, both northbound and southbound, and safe pedestrian use both sides of the street. So that's the goals that we have in mind for the project. So we'll be increasing vehicle capacity just slightly with four traffic lanes. And you'll see a little section that we put together here, and I think it's the next slide. You'll see protected bicycle lanes. And what this means is it's not just the striping that you see against the gutter for bicycle lanes, but it's actually protected with a barrier and some planting treatment, so it's kind of a cool thing. Like I mentioned, we'll be having sidewalks on both sides. Right now, we just have the sidewalk on the west side. Now we're talking about wide city standard 12-foot sidewalks on each side of the street. And also the retaining wall, I think Jerry and Nate have both mentioned, there's a huge issue with runoff off the hillside coming down onto the roadway. We're going to mitigate that. We need to construct the retaining wall that you'll see in the next slide. But with that, we're going to have enough drainage apparatus and facility to take care of anything that might come on the hillside. So this is the section that is the desired cross-section of the project. As we talked about, we have a 70-foot right-of-way currently, and that's measured really from this point, which is the Forever 21 property, is right over here. So basically it takes from this point, and we have a 70-foot right-of-way. Only about 38, 40 feet is actually roadway. So what we're proposing is the sidewalk on either side with roadway lighting as well as low-level pedestrian lighting and street trees. This is your protected bikeway, 6 feet wide, one here, one on this side here. And these are your raised curb protected elements with planting in them. And these serve another purpose as well for stormwater cleanup. This location here, we have a very narrow painted median, and then the roadway lanes here, as you see here, two northbound and two southbound. These just depict our catch basin inlets for stormwater, and we'll construct the laterals, the main line, we'll get that south and north to capture rainwater in the project. We plan on draining everything coming off the hillside into the bear. So much improved over what we have. This block here represents the potential location for electrical vaults underground. The Jerry mentioned we'll be getting rid of all those overhead power poles. On the east side, we might have one pole remaining on the west side, just for the way that the structures need to come together. But you'll see those power poles on the east side. So much improved visually, as well as functionally with better pedestrian bicycle.
Excuse me. Are you raising any questions?
I don't know.
So to be clear, this is parallel to the actual hill. We're not talking about Multnomah Street hitting Soda.
No. It's from Multnomah. It's Soda from Multnomah north to right where the current project is finished, where it makes that turn. That's the project limits.
This is kind of the worst case scenario, if that's your question. Kind of in the middle of the project, where the hillside is the largest. That's what this graphic basically represents in its scale.
So does it actually hit the Valeria Market?
It'll stop.
Before.
Probably 1,000 feet.
I'm just trying to get a visual.
Sure. Yeah, no, I understand what you're saying. So what you're referring to is this area here.
Yeah.
If you notice here, the curb to curb actually is about 90 feet in here already. And as you come in, as you go towards Soto, heading towards Pasadena, it comes in like that. So
yeah,
this cross section we're referring to is probably like the worst condition along the hillside right there.
Okay, perfect.
And that's a good point Jerry brings up as well, is the curb line in the ultimate cross section will be kind of straight from here.
Yeah.
Straight from here. So that's the width you're kind of looking at.
Excuse me, what's the height of your retaining wall?
It's up to about 30 feet in height.
Up to about 30 feet, and you said draining.
Yeah, they're going
to
show you some options. They're going to show some
options.
We're getting there.
The bike lane. Is that going to be a solid divider all the way through?
No, it'll have breaks in it for drainage purposes.
That's scary, because when these bikers cut across and they're coming over that hill at 40 miles an hour, now you're giving them a lane, and then they want to go across the street and not wait till they get to the corner.
There shouldn't, that's a good point, thank you for that. There shouldn't be a reason to get across in this particular segment, because there's not really another destination to go to, but we'll consider
it's
that.
Just because they want to.
Yeah.
And there's no reason or line, right? I've seen them hit so many times just crossing the streets because they want to get somewhere.
Sure.
It's faster over there, whatever the reason. It's just scary that if you're going to leave them slotted open, that you're just asking for an accident there.
That's a good point.
Thank you.
So from the hillside, how many cubic yards are you expecting to remove?
I'd say it was
47,
40,000, 45,000, something like that.
Yeah. It's going to be a lot of earthwork involved for sure.
And you guys are just going to put a straight wall? You're not going to angle it to give it more?
Give it just one second.
Okay.
I got some things right here.
The wall design is not finalized.
Okay.
There's a lot of work we need to do for field investigation to determine the geotechnical characteristics of the hillside that will determine the final wall type. Right now, we're not thinking we'll have a batter on it. It will not lean back, but that is something that may happen in our analysis.
So that wall comes in every rainy season, every storm. comes in, so I mean, you're just gonna have so much pressure, it's gonna crack right away.
So, this is our project budget here. This is a Metro granted project. We do not have any federal funding here, such as Highway Bridge Program, which we use on SOAP project. So we have approximately about $6 million coming from Metro grant funds, which our Bridge Improvement Program applied for. And then the City of LA sponsored a match of about $3.2 million, for a total of about $9.3 million. This is a tentative project schedule, which we're looking at right now. Mainly right now, we're in the environmental documentation stage right now. GPA is helping us out with that, as well as the environmental management group. Probably seen some folks walking up the hill, doing some analysis. You'll see a lot more of that in the coming months, doing their reports and all that. And a few months from now, we'll have the EDA start working on the design process, generating the plan specs and estimates. Looking to be completed by May of next year, 2018, and then hopefully getting into the bidding award process after that, and in construction at the end of next year, if all was for time. So I wanted to touch on this because I know that was one of the reasons we chose DEA, David Evans Associates, because they pretty much have the state-of-the-art technology software which we'll be using to design this project. I'm sure most of you heard, but yeah, we're using a software called Civil 3D Design. It's an AutoCAD software program, which it's going to improve the project delivery of the project, and it's going to maintain like the data more consistent, so we're able to make changes on the fast. It's basically using, instead of the old school way of 2D, we're now using the 3D way of designing it, so we're able to, you know, make some changes on the spot. David Evans Associate also can do ground penetrating radars, so before we even start digging anything in the road, we can determine what's actually in the roadway, so abandoned oil lines or, you know, or whatever it is that we can find in there, we can do that in the design phase. And then InfoWorks provides more of a presentation and rendering ability for you guys. So as we move on with the design, we'll be coming back and presenting to you what we're doing, what we're accomplishing. You want to add a little bit more to that?
Yeah, if you go to the next slide, I think there's a couple of examples. The Civil 3D work, it just, like Jerry had mentioned, it just gives us you're always designing in three dimensions, which is important in so many aspects in any type of civil engineering work. So that's a tool that we've been using for years and years now in the province. The radar is helpful, and this is an actual, this is up at, I want to say this is First Street, and it's right by the Metro station right here, right down from the Disney Concert Hall. So this is an actual layout of all the, everything is underground, and it can be very, very congested. And so this is kind of what that GPR, ground penetrating radar, starts to give us as a way of just. And then InfoWorks is something, you can take an aerial photograph, and you can basically put a simulation on it of your project. So like Jerry mentioned, when we come back to you as the project design progresses, to show you kind of the visual and give you the best visual simulation of what we think this thing will look like, so you have a comfort level and how it all comes together if that's actually constructed.
Hi, so this project is subject to CEQA, which is the California Environmental Quality Act. And we'll be working with the city's environmental management group. And they are ultimately the lead agency, which is responsible for approval of the environmental document and the technical studies that go with it. The proposed environmental document that's going to be prepared is an initial study with a mitigated negative declaration. There's several technical studies that are prepared to support the information and analysis that's in that report. There's a biological resource study, the cultural resource study, the air quality report, hazardous waste, initial site assessment, and a traffic study. Once the technical studies are approved, we prepare an initial study that gets reviewed by internally by the city and the city staff. And then we circulate it for public review for like a 20 or 30 day comment period. So most of you in here will get a chance to read the analysis and comment on it. And that's scheduled to be complete by the middle of September, tentatively. And then after we compile all the comments, we circulate that again, we file the notice of determination, which certifies the environmental document.
Okay.
I have a quick question. I have documents here about initial study being done for this project 2009. Is this a new initial study and MND?
Yeah, it is. I think the project changed.
Okay.
And it didn't go through all the way to completion.
Okay.
So I think somewhat of the design changed for the project, and so they wanted to go back and redo portions of the initial study.
Good. I have some questions about, well, in this study, the schools that are around here, Multnomah Elementary, I'm a parent from Multnomah Elementary, high school, it declares that there's no schools within the vicinity of this project. And I was concerned about that because you're moving a lot of soil and into the air. So as a parent, I would like to know that that you know,
that's a
concern that happens is within two.
Yeah, absolutely. Part of the analysis is identifying all the schools within the, like within the radius of the project, within the project location. So we'll identify all the schools and report any potential impacts that it will have on it. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
The CEQA, did it already start or is it been?
The CEQA, it really officially started once we got under contract. We started doing the technical studies. We actually did, part of the CEQA process is AB 52, which is you initiate consultation with all the Indian tribes that are in the area. So letters were sent out, I think, at the end of June. So that kind of officially kicked off the CEQA process. For the initial study, you don't have to prepare and then a notice of preparation. That's only required for an EIR. So that's really what kicked off the CEQA process was the AB 52.
And there's going to be ample, I mean, it'll be totally transparent in terms of review from our office. I believe we have a public hearing for it in September.
Okay.
To give people input on it. So everyone will have an opportunity to read all these, you know, comment on it, provide things that, you know, modifications, changes, whatever. But they're doing a ton of studies and, you know, analyses, just like Jorge, you're mentioning, to make sure the schools are there. I mean, that's an old document, an old study. I mean, there's probably some relevant information, but assume this is a brand new study.
But in that document, it was never approved by the city council.
It's a study, right?
Yeah.
When you say you're going to ask for comments, what's going to be done with the comments that are given?
They'll be part of the final initial study, which is ultimately a mitigated negative declaration. We'll compile all the comments that are received and provide responses to those comments.
But are they going to assist you in an outcome? Or are they just going to be filed somewhere?
Yeah, no, they would, definitely.
So, you would compile the comments, you give it to the decision makers, and they review them and take into account your comments, the analysis, and then make a decision on the project.
And who exactly would be the decision maker? Or decision makers that you're referring to?
City Council.
City of LA.
City Council.
And I don't know, maybe it's a dumb question, but why are we having an MND instead of an environmental impact report? I just feel like these three projects were piecemealed, where it's really a big project that we're doing from starting from the bridge all the way to Solon Valley. So I feel like an EIR would have been more appropriate.
Well, they serve an independent utility, each project individually. And they've all been on very different schedules. I mean, that's something that the city's really evaluated, whether it required environmental, a full environmental, or MND. However, based upon the consultant's initial analysis, they feel an MND is the proper environmental document for it. Obviously, the public is totally welcome to weigh in and say, you know, whatever they feel on it. But the studies are being conducted pretty intensively. We actually asked for additional studies because of where the area is and the history of the, I think it's the Tonga Indians or somewhere, sure that the cultural studies were well done, the soil boring. So there's pretty intensive studies going into this, and obviously if people see the studies and think that things aren't done well enough or whatever, I mean, that's people's purview, and the city has to factor those in. I mean, if someone says, okay, they want, you know, they want to make sure that, you know, someone builds giant statues of pink elephants all up and down the corridor as an environmental thing, the city's obviously not going to do that. But there are things that people are going to bring up that are very legitimate issues and brought up all the time, and the city has to address those.
And during this process, you know, we're working with the engineers as a city, and as the design process is dynamic, changes are made, because we're going to analyze it within technical documents, and if we come up and we find an impact that we cannot mitigate through this process, then we'll will the city have to upgrade to a EIR? But if we could find, we go through the process, we can mitigate everything to less than significant, it stays in the initial study MND.
You know, like you stated about the pink elephants, with the bridge that was built over here, there was a lot of stuff that was done there that the community didn't agree with,
which
but that the councilman chose to put up there.
What are you talking about?
The bridge that went over the train tracks. On Soto on the other side.
Valley?
I mean, Valley, I'm sorry. There were a lot of statues and everything put up that, that weren't okay with some of the community.
What statues are you referring to?
I'm referring to the artwork.
The artwork?
Yeah.
That was, there was a specific community process for that, where we had community meetings at Rose Hills Rec Center. I remember very specifically, I know people in this room.
The artwork on Valley Bridge?
Yeah.
By Mariana?
Oh, that? I wasn't here then, so I can't speak to that.
No, I'm just making a comment that there's a lot of stuff that was done that some of the community didn't agree with.
And
that were done, in my opinion, behind closed doors.
And this,
and we were stuck with it.
And this process will not be behind closed doors, and that's why we're here at the very beginning, before the environmental process even starts. We asked the Bureau of Engineering to do additional outreach beyond what is required by law. For example, this is just the first of the, you know, there's going to be a lot of things people are going to have feedback on, things they're going to want to address. And what we want to do is provide the initial project information to you all, and to begin to engage you all in the process to see what the scope is, to provide your feedback. But what I want them to do is just sort of, you guys can get through and just talk about some of the ideas we have for the retaining wall and the other things to make sure, you know, it's a project that serves the community.
We'll be happy to take more questions at the end of the presentation as well. Okay, so I was talking about community art and architecture. So one of the things we're looking at is, what are some of the elements that we can bring in this art and this architecture to get community feedback in? And we're thinking the fencing might be one along both sides of the sidewalk. That might be an option there. Improving the hillside village signs that you see out there, maybe, you know, making it brighter, bringing in some light, or, you know, whichever we can. And then installing a potential green wall is something that we, some ideas that we've been thinking about for the retaining wall. Now, what is a green wall? What we've been thinking about is it's a green infrastructure vertical wall, which we believe that, you know, it can have endless possibilities as to what we can do with this big, you know, canvas of concrete that we're going to have out there. Obviously, you know, we see the wall that's being constructed here, that just was constructed across the street from Hazard Park there. I see a lot of graffiti there all the time, and every other time I see somebody painting over it or graffiti over it. And so we're thinking about these things as we're designing, and one of the ideas we thought was maybe, why not maybe build some kind of green into this wall? And so, you know, we can help by, you know, the plants that we planted, it can help purify the air, mitigate heat effect by cooling the air, detoxify airborne pathogens, mitigate graffiti, obviously, reduce noise and erosion, create a habitat for the butterflies and for the natural wildlife in there. These are all things that are, you know, within the green elements of this project. So, you know, we thought of some ideas, some photos we'd like to share, possible design concepts that we can implement into this project. Here's one here, you know, various types of plants, different vertical plants and colors, as you can see. This is a large scale one, you know, possibilities are endless. Incorporates the lighting as well, as you see down here, to, you know, bounce off the walls at night and bring in some more of a, you know, ambient environment. So with that, that concludes our presentation. You know, we'd be happy to answer any additional questions and answers.
Before you do, Jerry, just really quick, this is, like I said, this is just the beginning of that process. You know, the examples Jerry showed of the green walls and all that, that's just things that people have thought of and ideas, right? And that's where we're going to come to you guys and say, because graffiti obviously was our first concern. Like, we don't want a giant canvas for tagging, right? And it was actually Jerry's idea, was like, well, how do we get around that? You know, what are things that people won't tag on, and how does it become something that's an aesthetic benefit to the community?
Okay.
So that's one example. You know, the Hillside Village sign, you know, fortunately, because we don't have federal funding, we have a little more flexibility. So the thought is, you know, what does the community want to see as an entry point to Hillside Village? Like any city project, you have a percentage that the city has to spend on public art, right? So that, we see that as an engaging process with the community about what you all feel defines your neighborhood. And that can be incorporated into the project.
Someone said Sereno signs too up here. Someone said Sereno signs, is this a part of Sereno?
Well, what we're gonna do is the community here will be able to help shape that. If the community wants that, they're more than happy to. But what we hope is that this group is gonna be able to provide feedback on that. Things like, for example, tree species, right? If people have certain trees they want, or types of street lights or planting, I mean, this is your opportunity to help define how that corridor is gonna be for the next 100 years. And that's why your feedback is so incredibly important about what this looks like. So I can't emphasize enough that this is just literally just the beginning of this process.
Yeah.
Are there any plans on maybe cleaning up that dairy area, the hillside where it starts? I mean,
dairy?
Well, I call it a dairy, the little market there.
The little market area.
Oh, yeah.
We can look into the design. I mean, we might be replacing the sidewalk and curbs in that area. That for sure.
I mean, we can't touch the private property,
right.
But the public we can touch. I mean, if you see right there how it's wider there, right? The we're gonna need to make it safe and passable. Like you see that there's not ADA ramps right there at the corner of Multnomah and Soto. That is gonna be incorporated into it because we have to look at that, making sure that sidewalk there, because it's gonna be wider the whole way down, has lights the whole way down. So that's gonna have a natural beautification element on the Soto Street side of it. Private property we can't control, but what we can do is we can control the public.
Is there any way on the Forever 21 sign that they have to be responsible so they don't have the weeds growing up into the sidewalk?
That's the beauty of the fencing ideas and some of the strategies.
Just
no, you're right.
There. You can't even walk through there.
There's always weeds growing there.
You're right.
Yeah. Maybe go back to that one slide again, Jerry. One of the photographs.
Down a little bit.
In this area here. Our project basically will replace everything from about this location over that's within the public right of way. So the public right of way, the street right of way is at
right
about
here.
This location.
Right.
So like Nate indicated, you know, all they can do is get code enforcement or something like that to, you know, have this guy help clean that up. But all of this, you know, the bad sidewalk, the leading fence materials, that'll all be new.
For the type of fence you guys think, you know, maybe you're thinking that obviously is not a very safe fence that nowhere near meets city code. So, you know, there, I think that will be addressed definitely.
Let's see, like you said in the picture right there, looks like a hill shifting right there on that side with the sidewalk and the fence going into Forever 21. I mean, you guys replace it, how long is that going to stay level, you know, without the hill shifting?
Right. All of our geotechnical analysis, mm-hmm. and which on earlier on the slide when Jerry was showing the project team, that's Hushman and Associates, who we've worked with for years and years, and they work all over the city. They have a very good reputation. Anyway, they will do all of their borings to find out what's going on under the ground. Why is there any shifting, or what are the reasons for all of this? It could be some underground.
That's a good point.
That's a good point. This is rotating over for some reason. Why is that? Probably the loads from the roadway and insufficient subgrade soils here are starting to fail.
On the right side of your wall there, on the right side of the curb, yeah. How many feet are you going to go into the gateway?
We go in about, I want to say about 30 feet from this location.
And what's the limit that you can go in? I mean, that's private property, right?
Yes, it is.
What is there a limit that you can go in?
We're at the limit.
30 feet.
Yeah, we're at the limit with that cross with a 90-foot right of way.
90-foot
is as wide as we can.
But from that curve, it's probably 30 feet.
Yeah.
And then your retaining wall will start where the hill starts.
It starts several hundred feet north of the mini mart. As we get to a situation where we have to retain earth,
right.
Wherever that begins, that's where our wall begins, and then it'll be a meandering height, variable height all the way along the project. So. that in itself lends a little bit of aesthetic look to it because it's not a straight.
And the top of the wall, what's, is it like a fence in there or something secure when people clean up there?
Not necessarily a fence at the top, but we'll provide drainage facilities behind it.
Oh, maybe not going into the top of the wall, but like from the little market area, people walking up, because now you're talking about a sidewalk and there's more foot traffic.
There was people that lived back there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right in the tree.
It's a great point, and our goal is to make sure that people aren't walking up there because obviously liability for the city.
Because I'm paranoid. I'm having him build a fence up on that hill.
Yeah, I mean, Luann said broken glass, so I mean, I don't know. I'm kidding.
Our property is the first property right next to the fence.
Oh, yeah, all right.
Yeah, that's our first, yeah.
Two concerns I have. One is, as the construction's going on, because they are going to be removing a lot of dirt from the hillside, will the street always remain open for traffic to go through? And will there be a pathway for our students and pedestrians to continue to walk while the construction's going on?
Very good question.
No, go ahead, you can answer that. I don't know.
Okay, very good question. We will always maintain two lanes of vehicular traffic. We'll construct the street in phases. We'll do one side and then the other. And it depends on the final placement of the underground electrical walls, whether those will go generally on the west side of the street or the east side. So, yes, to answer your question, always one lane each direction, and always ped access along the project.
Okay. The second question is, I know you're talking about, and I know nothing's installed yet, you're talking about the green wall. What is a commitment from the councilman once the wall is put in place to maintain the wall? Because we have things that happen and we put grass in the middle of the pathway and then nobody cuts it and things like that. So what is a commitment from the councilman to, once the project is up in place, to maintain the wall? Because it's, yes, it's a green wall and, you know, it's after a year, so it's not going to look as beautiful as it does in the picture. So is there money in the project put aside to maintain that, or will that be something that the councilman will commit to in order to keep the wall looking
so that's something and clean? So it's not within the project budget, but okay. For example, I can give you a Lesotho mission that was done. There was a lot of discussion we had on the landscaping down there. We didn't want to have it be something that became an eyesore, right? And we spent a lot of time going back and forth with the Bureau of Street Service to make sure that the scope was something that could be maintained within their city contracts, right? So we plan on doing a very similar thing here with that design. It doesn't benefit anybody for it to look
off. Right.
But that's really gonna determine what the design is, you know, and what type of maintenance is needed, right? But we have the city has 1,000% commitment to maintain. We're not gonna leave it looking off. Probably incorporating one of the city maintenance contracts to make sure that it's trimmed or the Bureau will do it or whatever. But yeah, it's not gonna
about the alley behind the wall? I've seen the property, right?
The alley is.
How can you mitigate the problem with them if there are people dumping the trash? Like, if you haven't got the pot of water, you put a chain to keep the trash dumping.
You can fence off the alleyway. The thing is, they're going to drive around it. I mean, or they're going to walk around it, right?
You said we're earning the design fees. Yeah, we can look at different options.
I figured because the city.
Yeah, we can look at different options, maybe putting in some barriers in there, prevent people from driving in, throwing trash in there. Different things, for sure.
I know this kind of might be a dumb question, but with all that dirt being moved, how are you going to mitigate the dirt, the airborne dirt, dust that falls on everybody else's houses and cars and lungs and everything else?
So we're required for environmental, and that's what our studies are, to have a specific definition of how that dirt needs to be handled. For example, you know, where it's trucked to, how it's covered, how they remove the dirt, how they it's really intensive environmental that we're required by law to follow. So for example, when that document comes out, if you guys feel, okay, well, they need to handle the dirt a little bit better, that's where people write comments and say, this needs to be handled better, and the city addresses it.
So we won't know until it gets made.
It's more of a construction question you're asking about. But yes, you're right. Nate is kind of right. You have to have a contract to comply with what we call best management practices. Really to, you know, maintain water, you know, have water out there if you need to during the excavation process. Cover stuff up when they're taking it out. These are all kind of practices that every contractor should comply with. But I myself, I was a construction manager on this project that we're just completing now. And I can tell you, you know, we're working with the Bureau of Contract Administration inspectors. We get on those contractors for all that. They know what to do, and if they don't, you know, we issue non-compliances for that. So we monitor it every day as well. But there is best management practices that every contractor has to comply with.
Most of the dirt trucks that actually come into here are not covered.
Yeah, some of them are not, some of them aren't.
Majority of them aren't.
And that's something that can be addressed in the environmental document, right? You can say all trucks have to cover their dirt or whatever on their layout. I mean, that's the type of thing.
When they tore the bridge down, there wasn't that much dirt. Now you're talking about a lot of dirt.
Yeah. You definitely have to think about it.
Trucks aren't covered, they're gonna have dirt wherever way they're going.
Yeah, you make a good point, and I think it's definitely something that we can incorporate into the project specifications. You know, to make sure that the contractor complies with it, you know, hauling and delivering of the soil. So, yeah, it's a good question.
Have we talked about, do you want to talk about anything with the speed limit or anything increasing the frequency than anything? You're only gonna have one signal.
Yes.
So the speed gonna stay the same?
Speed limits are governed by, the state has very specific regulations about speeds.
You're opening it up.
Yeah, well, if you wanna put a new speed or do a new speed on a street, you have to do a speed survey. And the way it works is you have to set the speed limit, I believe it's 15% above whatever people are driving. So a lot of times when you do those speed surveys, it increases the speed limit. Yeah, exactly. So,
but you got bikes.
Yeah, I mean, so it's a major issue with state law, and it's something the city has. I mean, when I see Valley Boulevard is 40 miles an hour, why is that? Can we reduce it? No, because if we did it, it would go up to 60. So, you know, reducing speed limits is something that the city is creatively trying to address. But it is, you're absolutely right, it's an issue. But it's a state law.
Here and there are two houses. So I'm a resident in the area. But I'm also here on the House of Council District 1, which is the one across the street. So we're on the other side of Seto. So I'm not sure if we looked over our map again. So we know Forever 21 is definitely in the first district, all the way to Valley, and to where we come around the bend and hit where Mission comes together.
Right.
So it's not clear if we go to the middle of the road or we're at right. So that's one of the things. So obviously we learned about it because we're a resident. And I've heard this before about the widening before that goes to the goal 2 south of the mine. And then there's been changes along the way. And so one of the things you mentioned with pedestrian lighting, the maintenance issue, ongoing maintenance is a concern. That's always a problem, as Nate and I know in all our projects that we do. We, in commercial areas, a lot of it easier if we have a DID who can assist in ongoing maintenance when we plant our trees and stuff. But that is a major concern, especially for something of this magnitude, we would be maintaining that. I'm glad it's on the east side of the street, so then it's even for Keith's problem. I do raise some issue though in terms, you mentioned pedestrian lighting, so that requires a Prop 218. And so then it's a question of what proof was the ownership issues on the adjacent properties that would get assessed on this roadway. So you need at least a 51%. So Forever 21, the other side of the property in the MWD part of it.
Don't know the exact property.
So those are where, you know, the properties are. So you need to make sure that that is an issue you're proposing. Nate and I know this from our other projects. I have one that's coming along where PED margins are included in the grant, and nobody's done a Prop 218 for it yet. So, and we have multiple property owners. So, in one sense, it's good if it's single, a couple of the LASQ, we're not going on the other side, LAUSD property, that's a property owner, usually a public entity, the best ones to take votes. So we'll just be the host, but when you have a private entity, it's difficult to get that to tax themselves. So that is an issue in terms as we go forward.
And we have, our goal was to initially first brief the committee on the general project scope, But yeah, Prop 218, yeah, and figure out what people things are. I mean, we're obviously going to go into all the adjacent, like Forever 21, we're going to have to have a meeting to discuss this with them. But the first thing is, hey, here's what it is, guys, here's what's going on, you know, total transparency, this is coming down the pipe, and to get everyone's initial feedback.
So we would help you with the starting this forward, and we also inform the council.
Absolutely. Any other questions? Great, thank you all so much. We should have our scoping meeting, or in probably September, in September. So we'll make sure everyone knows about that. That won't be the last meeting, because we still have to obviously go into design details about what types of things people want. That's the official environmental meeting. I highly recommend Jorge and Yoli and anybody else who has comments to, you know, definitely read it, submit your comments, what it is, so that those can be addressed whenever they are. Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are you there?